Okay, I think we can go ahead and stop sharing the slide now. Perfect. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Gatsos in Translation, a celebration of the 110th anniversary of the birthday of Nikos Gatsos. I am Keith DeStone of the Harvard University Center for Hellenic Studies. Kalimera, Kalispera, ke yasas to those of you watching in Greece and around the world in nearly every time zone. This translation project, and ultimately today's event, began in the events surrounding Harvard's acquisition of the Nikos Gatsos archive from Mrs. Agathi Dimitrouka, who is here with us today. Those events included concerts in Cambridge and Washington, D.C., and on the occasion of her visit to the center's campus in Washington, an idea was born of a way to bring the songs of Gatsos to an even wider audience. The project was initiated due to the vision and support of Professor Gregory Nagy, the most recent former director of our center, and it has been graciously continued by the further support of the current director, Professor Markshevsky, who will speak in a moment. You will see the results of this support in action during today's events. I need to add just a few more words of thanks, firstly to Anna Pataki of Pataki's Publishers, whose generosity has allowed us to share the full text of the songs of Gatsos. Leslie Morris in Harvard's Houghton Library, the curator of the Gatsos Archive, and Ray Lesage in Widener Library, the librarian for Hellenic Studies and coordinator for the classics. Zoe Lafis, the center's executive director, for her personal involvement and support, and Luke Hollis of the New Alexandria Foundation for his brilliant and up-to-the-minute work on the online platform. Thanks to all of you, and there are more of you, but for now, Professor Shevsky, I give the floor to you for a few words of welcome.
Thank you, Keith. It's my pleasure to welcome today's speakers and honored guests, as well as everybody in the audience, not only on behalf of Harvard University's Center for Hellenic Studies, but also on behalf of the co-sponsors of this event, namely the Harvard Library, which acquired the Nikos Gatsos Archive in 2018, as Keith described, and the Department of the Classics, which is indeed the institutional home of Harvard's Modern Greek program. Though our center focuses on the Greece of the ancient world, there's no denying the connective thread that runs throughout Hellenic culture, which looks back to ancient Greece while also moving forward. Nikos Gatsos, who was esteemed so highly and beloved both as a poet and as a writer of popular songs, reflects for us today this Hellenic spirit. And so it is with great pleasure and honor that I welcome you all to this celebration on the occasion of the 110th anniversary of Gatsos's birthday. I'd like to offer a special welcome to Mrs. Nana Mouskouri, herself an unparalleled icon of modern Greek music, who enjoyed a long collaboration and friendship with Gatsos. A special welcome also to my colleague, Professor Panagiotis Roilos, fellow member of the Classics Department and the distinguished holder of that chair of modern Greek studies, named for another of the truly great Greek poets, one whom Gatsos himself admired, George Seferis. I would also like to recognize and thank Professor Johanna Hanink of Brown University for joining us today, as well as Mrs. Agathi Dimitrouka, the poet's literary executor and a lyricist in her own right. Finally, I understand that we have among those watching today, Mr. Achilles Rakinas, a great friend of the center, formerly as the third secretary at the Embassy of Greece in Washington, and now as consul at the Consulate General of Greece in Benghazi, and also the Consul General of Greece in Boston, Mr. Stratos Efthymiou. I gratefully acknowledge their presence here. So without further ado, welcome to all and enjoy this marvelous event. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Shevsky. You have already given an introduction for Professor Roilos, and now I turn the floor over to you. Please go ahead.
Thanks, Keith. Thanks, Mark. I would like to thank Mrs. Agathi Dimitrouka for the invitation to participate in this event as well. An invitation she extended to me in my capacity not only as the Joseph Seferis Professor of Modern Greek Studies and of Comparative Literature, or a specialist in Greek modernism, but also as the instigator of the difficult but eventually successful process of bringing the Gatsos archive to Harvard. Agathi knows very well how deeply I respect Mrs. Mouskouri's unique, legendary, and multifaceted contributions to Greek song culture, and of course, Nikos Gatsos's work, which I have been teaching in the context of my courses on Western European and Greek modernism at Harvard for more than 20 years now. I want to thank also Dr. Keith DeStone for successfully coordinating the different constituents of this event. In my presentation of this cross-continental online event today, I'll draw extensively from my talk at the colloquium that I organized to celebrate the acquisition of the Gatsos archive by Harvard's Houghton Library on May 4, 2019, since distance and other practical reasons did not make possible for most of you to attend it. Να βρεις μια άλλη θάλασσα, μια άλλη απαλωσύνη. You should find another sea, another gentleness. As I was planning that May 4, 2019 event, which took place in a Park Thompson room at Harvard's Mahindra Humanities Center, I felt that this verse from Nikos Gatsos's Opus Magnum, Amorgos, may be heard also as a poet's self-referential comment on the inherent diasporicity of his, her verses that travel across spatial and temporal boundaries to reach new seas and new, incessantly renewed, receptive, refined ears and eyes. Like the pristine diasporicity of the Homeric winged words, the Epea Pteroida, or the swift flight of the Pindaric odes. As I have argued elsewhere, diasporicity is conditioned by perpetual oscillation between centrifugal and centripetal movements around real or imagined centers. Inherent in the concept and experience of diaspora, a Greek compound from dia, meaning across, and spiro, to soul, is the idea of procreative, spatial, and temporal dispersal, and thus distancing from a disseminating center and of the creation of new centers of dissemination. However, this centrifugal course is never emancipated, I argue, from its referentiality to the originary act of dissemination and that primordial ancestral center, which determines the state of the diasporic and the imaginary that emanates from it. Even if immigrated to another sea, another gentleness, μια άλλη θάλασσα, μια άλλη απαλωσύνη, to the exceptionally hospitable and generous Harvard Library in Cambridge, Massachusetts, the archive testament to Gatsos's work and life will remain essentially and perpetually diasporic. When Agathi Dimitrouka, Gatsos's companion for several years, contacted me about Gatsos's archive 5 years ago, its diasporic movement from its native land to Harvard became a fervent vision for me. To my mind, Harvard would be the best home, the best new disseminating center of the documents of the works and days of that major figure of the Greek avant-garde. And for very good reasons. Harvard has the longest tradition of promoting modern Greek studies among the universities of this country, and is the only one that confers a PhD degree in modern Greek. And for the last 10 years or so, this university has had the largest number in the USA of PhD students writing their dissertations on diverse aspects of modern Greek literature and culture from the late 15th century to postmodernity, including, of course, Greek modernism. Some of those students spoke, in fact, at the event in early May 2019. The teaching of modern Greek at Harvard goes back to the third decade of the 19th century. Almost 200 years ago, Alexandros Nervis, a fighter at the Greek Revolution against the Turks, came to Boston and taught the Greek language in 1828. In 1828, he published also a grammar of spoken Greek, the first grammar of this kind to appear in this country. The same year, Evangelinos Apostolidis Sophocles came to Boston. Sophocles was destined to become one of the most influential scholars in the field of Greek linguistics and lexicography. After some years at Yale, he became teaching at Harvard in 1842, and 18 years later, in 1860, he was promoted to full professor and appointed professor of ancient, Byzantine, and modern Greek. According to the Dutch scholar Dirk Christian Hesseling, Sophocles was the very first Neo-Hellenist. In 1919, in the period between 1919 and 1921, Evangelos Futridis, a good translator of modern Greek literature, many of Kostis Palamas's poetry, and a PhD graduate of Harvard, was appointed as an instructor at the Classics Department. In the years 1977-1984, Giorgos Savvidis was appointed as a long-term visiting professor and served as the first incumbent of the George Seferis chair. He was succeeded by Margaret Alexiou, the second incumbent of the chair, the George Seferis chair, until her early retirement in 2000. And the history continues. In addition to the very long academic tradition of modern Greek studies, Harvard boasts a unique collection of books on modern Greek literature, culture, and history, and in the modern Greek language. Considerably more than 300,000 volumes, including many rare editions in Kunabula, as well as important archival materials housed like the previous Gatsos archive at Houghton Library in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Nikos Gatsos was born in Arcadia, in the village of Assea, on December 8, 1911, and died in Athens in 1992. His emblematic poem, Amorgos, was published in one of the most turbulent and dramatic periods of modern Greek history, the occupation of his country by the Germans and their allies, Italians and Bulgarians, and soon was hailed as a pioneering work by his fellow avant-garde Greek poets. His contribution to the song culture of 20th century Greece has been immense. Greek songwriting has not been the same after Gatsos. Despite his scanty production of what may be considered poetry proper, he was recognized by almost all major representatives of modernism and the avant-garde in Greece as a master daskalos in matters of poetics. As I stressed in my letter, with which for the first time I brought the Gatsos archive to the attention of Harvard Library, urging its librarians to acquire that treasure of Greek modernism, it is very important for scholars in modern Greek studies, comparative literature, translation studies, and cultural history, not only at Harvard, but in the US as a whole and beyond, that this archive be housed at Houghton Library in Cambridge, Massachusetts, which would make it available to interested researchers. The archive is very rich. In addition to Gatsos's autographs, most notably of the Amorgos, all typed versions of lyrics and translations, many of which have autographic corrections. It includes the correspondence with him of, for instance, Odysseas Elitis, Nobel laureate in 1979, George Seferis, Nobel laureate 1963, Nana Mouskouri, Manos Hadzidakis, Arthur Miller, Gore Vidal, two versions of the script for the emblematic film America, America, annotated by Elias Kazan, various official documents, his personal library, and many other important items. The acquisition of the archive would not have been possible without the most commendable efforts of Rea Lesage and of Leslie Morris. They both instantly and enthusiastically shared my vision and materialized it in a highly professional and speedy manner. The publication of the Amorgos in 1943 established Gatsos as one of the major representatives of avant-garde Greek poetry. The appearance of that innovative long poem during the devastating occupation of Greece by the Germans and their allies, accorded Gatsos' work the status of an emblematic and propitious intervention in his contemporary Greek cultural life. Although other very important and influential examples of Greek avant-garde poetry had appeared since the beginnings of the 1930s, I'm referring here, for instance, to the works of Theodoros Doros, Nicolas Kallas, Andreas Epirikos, Odysseas Elitis, and of course, Nikos Ekonopoulos, Gatsos' Amorgos was the first extensive poetic composition in Greece to construct a surrealist discursive topos, where elements of the cultural past and contemporary history were intertwined. Not unlike other examples of Greek poetry written in accordance with surrealist discursive principles, for instance, Andreas Epirikos' 1935 collection Ipsikaminos, Blast Furnace, Amorgos was received with a great deal of bewilderment, if not with explicit animosity in conservative circles. For instance, a critic described it as a literary hocus pocus, written by someone who most probably was in need of psychiatric treatment. That critic singled out a number of phrases as evidence for his critical diagnosis. Quote, "And the dead nuns rise to dance with the sheep-bearers' breeches in the frozen valley," or, quote, "A distant bell dyes the sky with indigo," etc. Gatsos' good friend, Odysseas Elitis, took upon himself to defend Gatsos' poem against such unfair criticism. After explaining that the poem was composed, quote, "according to the poetic principles of André Breton, the founder of Surrealism," Elitis tried to save it from any accusations of an exaggerated attachment to foreign models by emphasizing that, quote, "its roots are essentially Greek and even more precisely Peloponnesian," end of quote. He goes on to extol its, quote, "paradoxical combination of Hilderlinian romanticism with an idiosyncratic Doric romanticism originating from Mani, from that region in southern Peloponnese, which is famous for its oral literary tradition and especially for its laments. The two Greek poets, Odysseas Elitis and Gatsos, as is also evidenced in their correspondence, had developed a highly comparable poetics that foregrounded the transformational correspondences between the natural world, especially of Greek nature, and what they perceived as transcendental ethical values. The longing for a life based on ethical purity, as they would call it, that would transcend the exigencies and constraints of socioeconomic reality, was of course not unique with Gatsos or Elitis. It constituted an important priority for many artists, intellectuals, and writers of their generation, and not only in Greece, but also in the rest of Europe, who reacted against modernity's alienating effects on individuals. This contrast may be interpreted, I argue, as a discursive mode and ethical stance closely related to lyrical poetry as a whole. In Theodore Adorno's words, quote, "the lyric work is always the subjective expression of social antagonism," end of quote. Despite its essentialism, Adorno's statement encapsulates crucial aspects of the tension between subjective voice and objective dicta, as this is often articulated mainly in modern and especially modernist and avant-garde lyric poetry. Leaving aside abstract, existentialist interpretive schemata that such a generalizing essentialism may involve, in post-industrial Europe, and especially, I would argue that in post-industrial Europe, and especially after the First World War, progressive thinkers and artists engaged in a critical distancing from the hegemonic compartmentalization of sociopolitical life and the gradual establishment of the economic as the most central and powerful arena of public life, and of interpersonal exchanges. Not rarely, critics of modernity, which as a rule was viewed as the product of post-Enlightenment optimistic logocentrism and positivism, reactivated ritual and mythical patterns of signification and communication. In fact, as Dimitrios Getronolakis has argued in his pioneering book, Greek Mythologies, Antiquity and Surrealism, many avant-garde thinkers, artists, and authors, despite their polemics against classical antiquity, developed a novel discursive strategy that he defines as mythogenesis, which often drew from related patterns of thought and deep structures of signification dominant in ancient mythology. Transformation and the transgression of ontological, epistemological, geographical, and chronological boundaries constituted discursive practices propagated by surrealists and contributing, as Getronolakis has shown, to what he defines as their subversive mythogenesis. Both Elites and Gatsos had successfully made use of the aesthetic and conceptual possibilities offered to them by the surrealist subversion of established boundaries between reality and myth or dream. Their experimental poetics transgressed the discursive limits that had been set not only by adherents of more traditional aesthetics, but also by pioneers of modernism in Greece, such as Georgos Seferis. Although the latter, Seferis, highly respected Gatsos' lyric sensitivity and linguistic mastery, he would not go so far as to endorse the associative and dreamlike juxtaposition of terms and images from markedly dissimilar semantic and pragmatic fields that shape Samorgosi's poetic topoi. This problematization of established criteria of artistic expression and poetic referentiality and the development of new ways to view or construct and record correspondences between the visible world and transcendental principles and ideas were alluded to already by the title of Gatsos' long poem. Nothing in the text refers to the actual meaning of the word Amorgos, the name of a beautiful island in the Aegean. Gatsos had never visited Amorgos, the island, and Amorgos, the poem, never lets any elements of the real homonymous island infiltrate as such into its surrealistically constructed poetic space. Major Greek poets of the time, Seferis, Elites, and Kallas, had explored the symbolic sociocultural and historical potential of Aegean islands from different, at times contrasting perspectives, but always respecting the semantic referentiality of relevant terms. Gatsos' work develops an entirely idiosyncratic approach to the topos of the Greek island. And it may not be fortuitous that, by contrast to the works of those poets, his Amorgos alludes more to the history and cultural tradition, including the folk songs, the oral literature, of mainland Greece, especially of Gatsos' native Peloponnese, rather than that of the Aegean. And this emphasis did not escape the attention of a sensitive reader like the poet Odysseas Elites, who commented on the Moraitiki Peloponnesian atmosphere of Amorgos. Already this incongruity constitutes a marked surrealist statement, which an imaginative critic might wish to interpret also as Gatsos' self-referential sphragis, as a comment on his own poetic presence and aspects of its specific sociocultural origins. The subversive function of the title is foregrounded also by the epigraph of the poem. It is a passage from Heraclitus, the obscure pre-Socratic philosopher from Ephesus. Κακοί μάρτυρες ανθρώπισιν οφθαλμοί και ότα βαρβάρους ψυχά εχόντων. The eyes and tears of those who have barbaric souls are bad witnesses for humans, Heraclitus's statement says. In a sense, this Heraclitean quote encapsulates the poem's quest for a new ethics, which would liberate the world from many manifestations of barbarity, like the barbarity that had dominated the largest part of Europe and Gatsos' own country as a result of the Germans and their allies' conquests. References in the poem to contemporary barbarism are cryptic and articulated through localized metaphors, but sustained throughout the carefully organized structure of the text. In a passage in Amorgos that reenacts the poetics of folk songs, the narrator refers to the battles between the Maniots and the Germans. However, it is mainly through an experimental reconfiguration of Hellenic historical and cultural tradition on the basis of topoi drawn from antiquity, Byzantium, the period of the Greek Revolution against the Turks 200 years ago, and folk tradition that Amorgos exposes and exorcises the darkness of the present. My indirect description of that work also is a kind of apotropaic poetic spell, an exorcism against evil, is intended also as a comment on the prominence of ritual discourse and imagery in it. Not unlike elitists and other major representatives of modernism and the avant-garde, for instance, T.S. Eliot or Bataille, Gatsos often resorts to traditional ritual acts, gestures, images, for instance, lamentation, fortune-telling, magic, etc., and folk beliefs, with a view to recovering the immediacy of a primordial, all-inclusive system of expression and communication, which modernity had suppressed. As a result, such a discursive network, which is often grounded on a synesthetic conceptualization description of the world, and purports to activate a broad corpus of shared, traditionally inherited knowledge, contributes, as I have argued elsewhere, to the lyrics function as a subjective expression of social antagonism, to recall Adorno's definition. A major feature of the ritual is its performativity, and its performance often involves an emotionally, spiritually, existentially fertile interaction among performers or between performers and audience. Amorgos is replete with references to performative arts, dance, music, singing, often in a ritual context, to the extent that it may be viewed as an exemplification of T.S. Eliot's assertion that, quote, all art emulates the condition of ritual, end of quote. Amorgos, and I'm finishing in a minute, with the exception of a couple of other texts, was the only poem that Gatsos ever published. After 1943, Gatsos gradually devoted himself to an art of a highly performative potential, to the composition of lyrics, which were set to music by some of the most important composers of 20th century Europe, including Manos Hadzidakis and Mikis Theodorakis. Leaving aside the question whether lyrics written for music in the era of modernity or postmodernity have the same socioaesthetic status or potential as poetry, I would like to stress that the majority of Gatsos' lyrics, like his emblematic poem and many of the works of his spiritual companion Odysseas Elites, aspire to the achievement of the same ethical artlessness and immediacy, the same all-inclusive communication with the world and other human beings. And it might not be fortuitous, but rather a testament to the same youthful vision, that Elites too experimented with a mode of writing close to that of lyrics. In a tantalizing, enigmatic, almost prophetic statement, in his Amorgos, Nikos Gatsos' narrator gives the promise of a future regenerative and redemptive song. Let us for a moment sacrifice our restrictive rationalism to the creative potential of poetry and listen to the following words as the verses of a poeta vates, a poet prophet, who cryptically foretells the future of his own voice, a voice that from now on, from 1943 onward, will resonate with the rhythms of lyrics set to music, So I'm reading that passage from Gatsos' Amorgos. There is an immortal stone where a human angel, as he was passing by, wrote a song that no one knows yet, not the craziest children, not the sagest nightingales. It is now locked up in a cave on Mount Devi. But when that angelic song rushes out against decay and against time, the rain will all of a sudden stop and mud will dry out. The snow, the mountains will melt, the wind will trill, the swallows will resurge. Good night then to you. I see clusters of falling stars rocking your dreams, but I hold in my fingers the music for a better day. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Roilos, for those important and enlightening comments, and also for the reading of part of Amorgos at the end. We'll now have a short poetic interlude. We'll hear a few readings of the song known in English as Paper Moon. We have with us today the poet of Argentina, Angela Gentile, who will read a Spanish translation first, and then we will hear two recordings of further translations. Please, Angela, go ahead. You should unmute your microphone, however. Oh, I'm sorry, Angela, we can't hear you. Your microphone is off. Can you unmute? Perfect. Please, start again.
La luna es de papel. Pájaros traerá la mar. Y la brisa estrellas de oro. Para besarte la mano y acariciarte el cabello. La lunita es de papel y la playa de mentira. Si me creyeses un poco, sería todo de verdad. Cuando me falta tu amor, el tiempo no se detiene. Cuando me falta tu amor, el mundo empequeñece. La lunita es de papel y la playa de mentira. Si me creyeses un poco, sería todo de verdad.
Y una de papel. Portaràs ell estrelles daurades per acariciar-te els cabells i per besar-te la mà. La lluna sembla de paper i la platja de mentida. Si en cregueres un poquet, tot de veritat seria. Sense el teu amor, el temps no s'atura. Sense el teu amor, la terra es torna menuda. La lluna sembla de paper i la platja de mentida. Si en cregueres un poquet, tot de veritat seria.
ورق ذا القمر الصغير سيأتي بالطيور البحر والهواء بالنجمات الذهبية حتى تداعب شعرك ويدك لتقبلها ورق ذا القمر الصغير وهذا الشاطئ وهم لو صدقتني قليلا لكانت كلها حقيقة يمر الوقت بدون حبك عسيرا والعالم بدون حبك أصغر ورق ذا القمر الصغير وهذا الشاطئ وهم لو صدقتني قليلا لكانت كلها حقيقة.
I would now like to welcome to the virtual stage Professor Johanna Hanink, Professor of Classics at Brown University and co-editor of the Journal of Modern Greek Studies. Also, Agathi Dimitrouka, Gatsos' literary executor, an author, translator, and lyricist in her own right. Dr. Nicolas Prevelakis, my colleague at the Center for Hellenic Studies, where he is assistant director of curricular development. And also he is associate senior lecturer on social studies at Harvard University.
Thank you, Keith. How long would you like us to speak for at this point, do you think?
10 or 15 minutes.
10 or 15 minutes, okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And Nicolas will help us with some of the...
I will help with everything, and I hope that you both can share your insights about your work and experience in translation in particular, Gatsos and beyond.
Okay.
Good day. Buenas tardes, Angela. Muchísimas gracias. Παρακαλώ να μου επιτρέψετε να διαβάσω κάτι πριν ξεκινήσουμε τη συζήτηση με την κυρία Χάνινγκ. As the poet's heiress, I feel grateful to many people who worked to have this celebration today. First, I thank the former director of Center of Hellenic Studies at Harvard University, Professor Gregory Nash, because he had the idea to create a platform for all the Gatsos songs to open them to translators around the world, and Pataki's publication for their generosity. I especially thank my editor and dear friend, Mrs. Anna Pataki, who is also the editor of the work of Gatsos and who kindly offered the text gratis. All this is the outcome of an event several years ago, the of Gatsos archived by Harvard Library. So I thank Professor Panagiotis Roilos, George Seferis Professor of Modern Greek Studies, for being interested in this and introducing me to Mrs. Reales as librarian of Hellenic with enthusiasm the archive. Thank you, dear Rea. And I express my respect to Mrs. Leslie Morris, curator of Agathos Archive in Houghton Library. My gratitude principally to Dr. Keith DeStone for leading this project and making this day reality, to developer Luke Hollis, and to so many people who are working on the digitalization of the archive, and of course, my wishes to the new translators. I also thank for her readings the very important poet of Argentina, Mrs. Angela Gentile, who writes in Spanish and Italian using Greek themes and giving prominence to Greek diaspora in Latin America. Finishing, I give my gratitude to Mrs. Nana Mouskouri, a very close friend of Gatsos and ambassador of Greek language as a global interpreter of his songs. My dear Nana, all my love. Και του χρόνου.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Agathi. That was beautiful. And προτιμάτε να μιλάμε σε ελληνικά ή πώς να κάνουμε αυτό.
Πρέπει, όποιος γράφει, και αυτό το έχω μάθει από τον Γκάτσο, έχει πατρίδα του τη γλώσσα. Και πρέπει να την δείχνουμε.
Εντάξει.
Και αυτό και για στην κυρία Μούσχουρη, η μεγάλη ευγνωμοσύνη που έχουμε και που έχω αυτό από την αρχή το λέω, είναι η διάδοση της ελληνικής γλώσσας. Έχω γνωρίσει πολλούς ξένους από διάφορες χώρες που ενδιαφέρθηκαν να μάθουν την ελληνική γλώσσα από τα τραγούδια που άκουγαν στα ελληνικά από την Άννα Μούσχουρη. Και τα τραγούδια που τραγούδουν στα ελληνικά, τα περισσότερα, ήταν του Γκάτσου.
Nicola, do you...
I'm putting already things in the chat.
Okay,
you may go on and then I'll
Agathi, μήπως θα μπορούσατε να μας πείτε λίγο για την δικιά σας εμπειρία με τη μετάφραση, επειδή και εσείς είστε μεταφράστρια, οπότε τι σχέση έχετε με τη μετάφραση?
Είμαι μεταφράστρια που μεταφράζει τα πάντα. Δεν μεταφράζω μόνο ποίηματα ή στίχους. Προσπαθώ για να μάθω καλύτερα τη γλώσσα, αλλά δεν είναι, η μετάφραση δεν βοηθάει μόνο να μάθουμε καλύτερα την ξένη γλώσσα, όσο τη δική μας. Γιατί έρχονται πράγματα που πρέπει να τα αναζητήσουμε στη δική μας γλώσσα. Δεν είναι εύκολο να τα βρούμε, δεν είναι εύκολο να βρούμε αντιστοιχίες. Πολλές φορές μεταφέρουμε μια ξένη λέξη με δύο λέξεις ελληνικές ή το αντίθετο. Επίσης, βλέπουμε τους μηχανισμούς της γλώσσας και προσπαθούμε πάντα πώς να το φέρουμε πιο οικονομημένα στη γλώσσα μας το κείμενο το ξένο, να μην πλατιάζει. Αυτό που θα προτιμούσα να πω είναι άλλο η δική μου δουλειά η μεταφραστική, γιατί είναι άλλο πράγμα. Έτσι, από πολύ παλιά κείμενα μέχρι σύγχρονα. Κυρίως από τα ισπανικά, από τα αγγλικά, μεταφράζω μόνο για παιδιά. Αυτό που θέλω να πω είναι τον τρόπο που έχω μάθει από τον Γκάτσο, φυσικά, γιατί τον γνώρισα όταν ήμουν 16 χρονών. Λοιπόν, από 17 ετών ήμουνα μαζί του, έζησα μαζί του. Λοιπόν, ως νέα που ήμουν, δεν είχα ακόμα διαμορφώσει το χαρακτήρα μου, ούτε είχα μάθει πολλά πράγματα, τα έμαθα από εκείνον. Λοιπόν, έτσι αυτό που θα ήθελα να επικεντρωθώ, σε αυτό που θα ήθελα να επικεντρωθώ είναι η μετάφραση των στίχων στην άλλη γλώσσα, που πιθανόν αυτό να ενδιαφέρει τους νέους μεταφραστές που θα προσεγγίσουν το έργο του Γκάτσου για μετάφραση.
Let me interrupt one second because I realize that people do not have access to the chat and emphasize, and I'll say more later, emphasize some of the things that Thi just mentioned, talking about translation, not only about translation, her experience as a translator, but translation in general, starting with this very beautiful quote I found by Nikos Gatsos, that whoever whoever writes has language as her country, right? One of the philosophers I like, Emile Cioran, said, one does not inhabit a country, but a language. This is what to have an identity, a national identity. And the other thing Agathi, what you said is that when one translates, the real difficulty and the real learning is not the language from which one translates, but the language, one's own language to which one translates, because this is where you need to do all the heavy work in adapting the mechanisms of the other language, make it something in your own, right? And then you went on to say how you met Gatsos very early when you were 16, and I'm waiting to see the rest, and I'll make sure to convey the summary of what you'll be saying orally, since we cannot use the chat.
Yeah, I'll just say briefly in English that there's an anecdote about the translator of Gabriel Garcia Marquez into English that someone asked, do you feel like your Spanish is up to conveying this literature? And the response was, that's not the issue. Is my English good enough for it? Οπότε νομίζω και εγώ ότι όταν μεταφράζουμε μαθαίνουμε και πολλά πράγματα για την δικιά μας γλώσσα. Και αυτό είναι κάτι άλλο που ήθελα να σας ρωτήσω είναι διαβάζοντας τους στίχους του Γκάτσου σε όλες αυτές τις γλώσσες, πιστεύετε ότι μαθαίνετε και άλλα πράγματα για τα ποίηματα τα ίδια, για ότι βλέπετε και άλλα πράγματα μέσα σε αυτά τα ποίηματα μέσω των άλλων γλώσσων ή πώς...
Δεν μπορώ να κρίνω από τις άλλες γλώσσες, μόνο από ισπανικά κάπως.
Από τα ισπανικά.
Ναι, και αυτό που μετράει στη μετάφραση των στίχων είναι και η μουσικότητα της γλώσσας που πρέπει να αναζητήσει ο μεταφραστής. Δεν μπορεί να μεταφράσει, ας πούμε, ξερά ή στεγνά ή όπως θα μετέφραζε ένα αστυνομικό μυθιστόρημα. Πρέπει να έχει και η γλώσσα έχει τη μουσική της. Και απλώς χαίρομαι πάρα πολύ και βλέπω τις διαφορές και τι πράγματα δεν μπορούν να περάσουν στην άλλη γλώσσα. Είναι πολύ περίεργη, πολύ περίεργο είδος το τραγούδι, η στιχουργία, το να γράψεις στίχους για ένα τραγούδι που είναι, και τους στίχους που γράφει ο Γκάτσος που είναι καθαρά ποίηματα. Είναι πολύ πιο δύσκολο σαν έργο, σαν επίτευγμα από ότι ένα ποίημα. Απλό, που παρουσιάζεται ως ποίημα, που είναι ένα προσωπικό κείμενο. Εδώ πρέπει να λάβει κανείς υπόψη του τους περιορισμούς που έχει, που επιβάλλουν τα μουσικά μέτρα. Η μουσική είναι συμμετρική. Πρέπει, δηλαδή, όταν γράψει στίχους πριν από τη μελωδία, ο στιχουργός πρέπει να έχει στο νου του ότι αυτό θα τραγουδηθεί, να μην μπορεί να μην είναι ατραγούδιστο. Επίσης, μέσα σε αυτό το λίγο το σύντομο, σε αυτή τη σύντομη έκταση που έχει, να μπορέσει να πει ό,τι θέλει. Ο Γκάτσος δεν λέει μόνο, δεν λέει μια ιστορία, βάζει πράγματα. Είναι οι γνώσεις που περνάει από κάτω, τα πολλά επίπεδα που έχει. Όταν πάει να μεταφράσει κανείς ένα τέτοιο τραγούδι, δεν μπορεί εύκολα να το μεταφράσει. Πρέπει να βρει είτε αντιστοιχίες στη γλώσσα του, είτε να κρατήσει μόνο το αίσθημα. Και θέλω να πω ότι όταν αυτό που έμαθα από τον Γκάτσο. Α, συγγνώμη, πρέπει να το σταματήσω για να πείτε στα αγγλικά.
Αγαθή, thank you. I think the best is what is about to come, I hope, because you talked about the musicality of the language, right? And of course, that is true in general, but even more, as you explained, in poets like Gatsos, who did not write poems first that then were put into music, but wrote poems with the music in mind. So the musicality is built in. And then the kinds of difficulties that one has in translating, of course, that kind of musicality to such an extent that, as you said, in the end, one sometimes has to go just with the feeling, translate the feeling and adapt the rest. At which point, I wonder if you can give us an example. Αγαθή, μπορείς να μας δώσεις ένα παράδειγμα. Ένα στίχο, κάτι.
Λοιπόν, τέλος πάντων, να πω αυτό που υπήρξε για μένα το πρώτο μάθημα στιχουργικής, ας πούμε, ήταν όταν έγραφε ο Γκάτσος στο Γιάννη το Φωνιά πάνω στη μουσική του Χατζηδάκη. Λοιπόν,
άρα η μουσική προϋπήρχε.
Προϋπήρχε βεβαίως και ήταν και δυσκολία πώς θα τον τρίτο στίχο, δηλαδή που λέει ο Γιάννης ο Φωνιάς, παιδί μιας πατρινιάς και ενός μεσολογγίτη. Αυτό λοιπόν μετά που συγγνώμη, στο σημείο που λέει ότι δεν μπόρεσε κανείς τον πόνο της να αντέξει, μονάχα, και ούτε ένα συγγενής να πει δεν βρήκε λέξη. Προσπαθούσε να το βάλει, να πει, ας πούμε, να το πει σωστά συντακτικά, να πει ότι δεν βρήκε να πει λέξη, ας πούμε. Λοιπόν, οπότε άλλαξε τη σύνταξη και για την μουσικότητα και για το γιατί τον βοηθούσε, αλλά είναι πιο μουσικό αυτό το να πει δεν βρήκε λέξη ακολουθώντας τη μελωδία.
As the person in this conversation representing the non-Greek speaking audience, could I ask Nicolas, could you summarize a bit of what Agathi is saying? And also I see that our fellow panelists, Dr. Kalliopiduro has a question. I wonder if we could work that in as well to this conversation.
Well, yes, because especially since it seems that we're moving even beyond translation, right? Agathi was mentioning how Gatsos would think, again, of the lyrics, of the poem, with the music in mind, and sometimes having to do adaptations of the syntax, of the order of words too, so that they fit the music that he had to write for, which I would say is a translation in itself, right? Of something you have in mind, the lyrics into the music. And Agathi was mentioning a very famous song Nikos Gatsos, or Yannis Sofonias, a story about a person named Yannis who comes back from jail. It's a very moving scene of how he's welcome in a home. By the way, I remember when Manolis Mitsias came and performed this concert for the acquisition of the Gatsos collection, and he said that at some point in the song, where everybody's speaking, right? So they welcome the person who came back from jail, and they speak about different things, but they don't mention anything about the murder, right? They have to keep quiet. And how he was instructed when he would sing that himself to lower the tone of his voice, right? So all kinds of adaptations.
Άλλο παράδειγμα της μουσικότητας είναι, ας πούμε, στη Μυρτιά που λέει, που επαναλαμβάνει και τη ρωτώ και τη ρωτώ. αυτό ήταν το, ήταν η μουσική, το μουσικό του αίσθημα το, τον οδηγούσε στην επανάληψη. Ο Πατσιφάς που είχε τότε την δισκογραφική εταιρεία τη Λύρα του έλεγε «Μα τι κάνεις, βαριέσαι να βρεις κάτι άλλο να γράψεις».
Και γιατί ήθελε την επανάληψη?
Για μουσική, για μουσική, για μουσική
του right, or sometimes repetition.
Τραγουδάκια η γλώσσα, δεν τραγουδάκια. Επίσης, αυτό που ξέρω από τον Χατζηδάκη είναι ότι ο συνθέτης, μιλάμε τώρα για τους σοβαρούς συνθέτες, έτσι, όχι για που γράφεις ένα τραγουδάκι έτσι να παίζεις, για τους συνθέτες. Λοιπόν, όταν γράφει τραγούδια, είτε έχει στίχους μπροστά του είτε όχι, έχει την προσοδία της γλώσσας του στο μυαλό του, της γλώσσας του στο μυαλό του και γράφει, δηλαδή, γι' αυτό μετά ταιριάζουν. Μπορεί πιο εύκολα. Ο Γκάτσος με το Χατζηδάκι, ο Γκάτσος έγραφε στίχους για να μελοποιηθούν από το Χατζηδάκι, που δεν θα μπορούσε άλλος συνθέτης να τους μελοποιήσει κατά τον ίδιο τρόπο. Και ο Χατζηδάκης επίσης στίχους που θα έγραφε ο Γκάτσος.
Αγαθή, να σα πω. I know that Joanna has more questions. Right, Agathi is reminding us the kind of chemistry that existed between Gatsos and Hatzidakis that went both ways. These both Gatsos would write lyrics or poems, having in mind how they would be put into music, and then Hatzidakis too would write the music, having in mind how it would fit Gatsos' poems.
Excuse me, I'd like to bring in Calliope now for her question.
And Calliope can do a translation to you.
Thank you very much, Keith. Κυρία Δημητρούκα, σας ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ που είστε σήμερα εδώ μαζί μας και ήθελα να σας ρωτήσω αν συμφωνείτε με τον Ελίτη που έλεγε ότι μία καλή μετάφραση είναι ένα σπάνιο λαχείο και ότι πρέπει να συντρέχουν πολλοί παράγοντες για να υπάρχει κάτι τέτοιο. Έλεγε συγκεκριμένα ότι ο μεταφραστής πρέπει να είναι ποιητής, να γνωρίζει καλά τη δική του γλώσσα, να μεταφράζει στη μητρική του γλώσσα. Και το τελευταίο που νομίζω ότι είναι πολύ σημαντικό και γι' αυτό κυρίως θα ήθελα να μας πείτε τη γνώμη σας, να αγαπάμε πάθος το έργο του ποιητή τον οποίο μεταφράζει.
Βεβαίως, αυτό έχω μάθει και αυτό έλεγε και ο Γκάτσος, ότι αντιμετωπίζουμε όποιο κείμενο και να έχουμε να μεταφράσουμε, το αντιμετωπίζουμε σαν ήταν αριστούργημα στη γλώσσα του και προσπαθούμε να το μεταφράσουμε όσο πιο αριστούργηματικά μπορούμε. Λοιπόν, αυτό που θα ήθελα να πω τώρα, μάλλον θέλει ο Νικόλας να το εξηγήσει.
Ή η Καλλιόπη, μπορείς να το... Έτσι δεν νομίζω χρειάζεται. Καλλιόπη, θα το πεις καλύτερα από
εμένα. Νικόλα, μη σου πάρω τη θέση. Τη θέση αυτή.
Καλλιόπη and Agathi both were stressing, of course, the how important it is to know well one's language in order to translate, but also to love the thing that you are translating. And Agathi was saying that Gatsos would say that when you translate something, you have to consider that which you translate at the moment, at least when you translate it, as if it was a chef d'oeuvre in its own language, which is perplexing to me. I mean, I wonder now, can you translate something you don't like? Can you translate a text you hate? I can have many examples of texts that, you know, have to be translated and which we don't particularly like. Anyway, I would like also Johanna to say a few words and comments too from Johanna, from your experience as a translator, recent experience as a translation from Greek to English. And if you can tell us a little bit about that and what led you to do such a thing.
Well, actually, I just want to pick up on the last point that Agathi made about seeing the piece that you're translating as a masterpiece, because I was just telling my dear friend Elsa Montilu the other day that I think that some, you know, when you're translating a literary work, it's almost like you have to fall in love with it. And maybe it's not the most beautifully written or, you know, expressive or sort of stylistically sophisticated thing, but it's yours for the moment. And so you kind of have to, you know, love it in that way that you love, you know, your partner, who might not be the best looking, funniest, most charming person in the entire world, but to you they are, you know, for at least some period of time. And I think then I love this idea of then that, you know, Agathi said that you see the text as a masterpiece, and then you attempt to translate it as masterfully as possible to sort of do some justice to it. And I think that that's such a wonderful point, because the author that I most recently translated, Andreas Karkavitsas, is very important, considered a very expressive, very good writer, but I translated some things by him that are not considered to be the greatest masterpieces. But for me, in those moments of translation, they were. And I think it really is this kind of like act of love and trust between the author and the translator in that moment in the process.
Johanna, may we ask you what your motivation was in translating this this text?
Well, for that text, I mean, I don't want to go too far away, but I think it was, you know, what we see with the Gatsos, I think, you know, two things. One is, you know, a desire to make a text accessible because, you know, you love it or because you think there's something interesting about it or because it, you know, you think it has the potential to speak to more people in different languages. But I think that there is also that, you know, when I, you know, first started reading the text, again, that kind of falling in love with the language and wanting to, you know, for whatever reason it particularly appealed to me, wanting to kind of re-spin it in my own words, I think is something that is, it's almost as if it were poetry rather than prose. I think that that's something very appealing about translation is to take a text you love and kind of make it your own.
Να πω πώς μεταφράζουμε τους στίχους.
Αυτό περιμένουμε.
Λοιπόν, όταν πρέπει να μεταφράσουμε μόνο τους στίχους, χωρίς να έχουμε στο νου μας τη μελωδία, μεταφράζουμε ελεύθερα, σαν ένα ποίημα σε ελεύθερο στίχο. Όταν μεταφράζουμε, θέλουμε να το μεταφράσουμε πάνω στην μελωδία, εκεί δημιουργείται ένα πρόβλημα. Δεν μπορούν όλα να μεταφερθούν ακριβώς, φυσικά, εννοείται. Αλλά υπάρχει και ένα πρόβλημα που το δημιουργεί η ίδια η μελωδία. Που ας πούμε, σε έναν Αργεντινό, ας πούμε, τώρα, αφού είναι εδώ η κυρία Τζεντίλε, λοιπόν, μπορεί μια μελωδία να ακούγεται διαφορετικά, να βγάζει διαφορετικό αίσθημα. Να μην ακούγεται, ας πούμε, ούτε τόσο λυρική, αν είναι λυρική, ούτε ή να είναι το αντίθετο, να ακούγεται ποιητική. Οπότε εκεί ακολουθούμε και αυτό πρέπει να συγκεράσουμε τα πράγματα. Μπορεί να βάλουμε και εντελώς διαφορετικούς στίχους ανάλογα από αυτό που μας δίνει. Παράδειγμα, σε αυτό έχω από τις δουλειές που έκανα με τις οποίες είχα τον Γκάτσο δάσκαλο, ας πούμε, έτσι, υπήρχε ένα τραγούδι από αυτά που είχε εναρμονίσει ο Λόρκα, που μιλάνε, που είναι δύο αδέρφια που λένε ο μικρότερος ότι θα γίνει καλύτερος σταυρομάχος από τον άλλον και τελικά γίνεται. Η μελωδία όμως για μας είναι μια μελαγχολική μελωδία, μια μπαλάντα για μας. Οπότε δεν μπορεί αυτό να είχε ένα αίσιο τέλος, ένα τόσο λαμπερό τέλος. Έπρεπε αυτός να πεθάνει πώς το λένε, έτσι, καυχισιάρης που ήταν. Έπρεπε να πεθάνει, να σκοτωθεί από τον Ταύρο. Λοιπόν, οπότε αλλάξαμε το τέλος και με υποσημείωση και γράφουμε τι γίνεται. Αλλά δεν πάει στο αίσθημα το δικό μας όταν το ακούμε.
Άρα το τέλος, Αγαθή, άλλαξε πώς?
Έγινε ένα σταυρομάχος από χαρτί. Πάνω στη μελωδία τα λόγια, γιατί έπρεπε να τραγουδηθούν. Αλλά τι να γίνει αυτός σταυρομάχος, ας πούμε, μεγάλος, για τη σαφή, ας πούμε, έτσι πάει, the cartel, τον πήγα συνειρμικά και τον έκανα the papel, ας πούμε.
Για να βγει το...
Ναι, για να βγει αυτό η μελαγχολία που έδινε σε εμάς, τους Ισπανούς, δεν δίνει αυτή τη μελαγχολία.
Α, μάλιστα.
Λοιπόν, θέλω να πω, παίζουν αυτά. Στο μάθημα στιχουργικής που κάνω, είχαμε ένα τραγούδι του Λέοναρντ Κοέν, πολιτικό τραγούδι, αλλά με πολύ στενό στίχο. Αυτό ελληνικά, για να κάνουμε πάλι πολιτικό τραγούδι, δεν έβγαινε η μελωδία. Αυτή για μας ήταν καθαρά προσωπική και ερωτική μελωδία. Λειτουργεί διαφορετικά κάθε γλώσσα. Λοιπόν, αυτός είναι ο δεύτερος τρόπος που μπορεί να μας τραγούδι.
Agathi, I'm not going to convey all of that, but just give a sense of this of the fascinating things that you're saying about sometimes how you have to change the lyrics and also the content itself to match the melody or to match the feeling, right? And how, for instance, in this song that you mentioned, if you can give us the title of Leonard Cohen, in which the music. It was a political song, but the melody somehow in Greek didn't sound that way. Και άρα,
Αυτό γινόταν για μας ερωτικό τραγούδι, γιατί ήταν πολύ στενός στίχος και εσωτερικός. Δεν ήταν, έχουμε ανάγκη, γιατί η γλώσσα μας είναι πολύ πιο αναλυτική από ό,τι είναι η αγγλική. Ακόμα και από την ισπανική είναι πιο αναλυτική. Mm-hmm. Λοιπόν, και αν έχουμε ανάγκη το μεγάλο στίχο. Δηλαδή, δεν είναι τυχαίο που έχει επικρατήσει δηλαδή ο σπουδαίος μας στίχος, αυτός που μπορούσαμε να εκφραστούμε και ακόμα διατηρείται ζωντανός, είναι ο 15-σύλλαβος. Στη σημερινή στιχουργία πάει στα δύο, στην κανονική του τομή, τη σολομική, δηλαδή οκτασύλλαβος ο ένας στίχος, επτασύλλαβος ο άλλος. Δύο 15-σύλλαβοι μας κάνουν ένα τετράστιχο σήμερα. Συχνά αυτό το χρησιμοποιούμε έτσι.
Keith tells me that we should wrap up in a minute, and I want to make sure that if Johanna, you have to say some last comment or some general question.
No, that's okay. I think only to thank Agathi for everything that she has done for so many of us in bringing this incredibly important archive to the public, and it's just a wonderful event.
In thinking of what you said, Agathi, about the melody and the content, of course, one thing that I have in mind, and hopefully it will be discussed later, is the epitaphios, which Nana Mouskouri mentioned, right? Which is two different versions, right? One more lyric and more epic. And I wonder if there are similar things in interpretation with Gatsos poems, where you get either different performances or different musics, one emphasizing one kind of emotion and one another.
Αυτό γίνεται. Είναι και διασκευές που γίνονται, που κάνουν επίσης με τα τραγούδια και τα αλλάζουν. Το άλλο όμως που είναι η άλλη εκδοχή είναι για να μεταφερθούν οι στίχοι, να μεταφερθεί αυτούσιο, ας πούμε, το ποίημα, το ελληνικό στην ξένη γλώσσα, είναι να βρει ο μεταφραστής ή ο στιχουργός, να βρει έναν ρυθμό στη δική του γλώσσα να αποδώσει όλα αυτά. Και γίνεται πια, οπότε μετά μπορεί να δημιουργηθεί ένα καινούργιο τραγούδι, καινούργιο στίχη και να μπει άλλη μελωδία. Δηλαδή μια αγγλική μελωδία ή μια ισπανική.
Θα πω και αυτό και μετά πρέπει να κλείσουμε. Right? So sometimes when, because we have to deal with songs, right? When we translate into a different language than Greek, sometimes it's the melody itself, right, that has to be adapted. So there's a choice, right? What you keep? You keep the content, you keep the melody, or do you keep the feeling? Or sometimes you don't keep the feeling, you change the feeling and it becomes something different, right? It's a completely new creation. Right? Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, Nicolas, for your hard work in translating, and Johanna and Agathi and Calliope for jumping in. For all of you for taking part in this sort of free-form, you know, conversation about the nature of translation during this event dedicated to not only Gatsos but also translation. And I hope in the audience we have inspired in you some of the feeling that motivates translators in approaching texts. So thank you all. So now we'll have another poetic interlude. Agathi, you will be reading. Here, the Star of the North, as it's known in English. You will read in Greek. Yes, can you read from the screen? It's on the screen. And then is Professor Maria Rosa Caracazzi there with you? She will read a translation, and then Agathi, you will read again. So Agathi, unmute yourself, and please go ahead.
Τα αστέρι του βοριά. Τα αστέρι του βοριά θα φέρει ξαστεριά. Μα πριν φανεί μέσα από το πέλαγο πανί, θα γίνω κύμα και φωτιά να σ' αγκαλιάσω ξενιτιά. Κι εσύ, χαμένη μου πατρίδα μακρινή, θα μείνεις χάδι και πληγή σαν ξημερώσεις άλλη γη. Τώρα πετώ για τη ζωή στο πανηγύρι, τώρα πετώ για τη χαράς μου τη γιορτή. Φεγγάρια μου παλιά, καινούρια μου πουλιά, διώχτε τον ήλιο και τη μέρα από το βουνό. Για να με δείτε να περνώ σαν αστραπή στον ουρανό.
Για στα ιταλικά δεν είναι τόσο όμορφο, αλλά τι να κάνουμε. Είπαμε για τη μετάφραση. La stella del nord. La stella del nord porterà il sereno. Ma prima che compaia una vela nel mare, diverrò onda e fuoco per abbracciarti, esilio. E tu, Mia perduta patria lontana, resterai carezza e piaga quando sorgerà il giorno in un'altra terra. Ora volo verso la festa della vita, ora volo verso la festa della mia gioia. Mie antiche lune, miei nuovi uccelli, cacciate il sole e il giorno dalla montagna per vedermi passare come un baleno nel cielo.
Ευχαριστώ, Μαρία. Η Μαρία Καρακάουζη είναι 20 χρόνια που ασχολείται με το έργο του Γκάτσου, καθηγήτρια στο Πανεπιστήμιο του Παλέρμο, η οποία δίνει συχνά στους φοιτητές της μεταφράσεις του Γκάτσου, που έχει κάνει έργα και έχουν διαρκώς πτυχιακές εργασίες. Λοιπόν, La Estrella del Norte. La Estrella del Norte traerá una noche serena, pero antes de que en el mar se divise una vela, me volveré marea y fuego para abrazarte, destiero. Y tú, perdida patria lejana, seguirás siendo caricia y herida cuando amanezca en tierra extraña. Ahora vuelo hacia la celebración de la vida, ahora vuelo hacia la fiesta de mi alegría. Mis viejas lunas, mis nuevos pájaros, ahuyentad el sol y el día de la montaña para poder verme pasar como un relámpago en el cielo. Gracias.
Thank you very much. I would now like to welcome back to the stage Dr. Calliope Duru. She is preceptor of Modern Greek in the Department of the Classics at Harvard University. And she will also be introducing two of her students. Please go ahead.
Thank you again, Keith, for the kind introduction. Teaching courses in modern Greek language and literature over the past 6 years has been a great blessing. Learning a new language is an exciting experience, and it is a unique opportunity for everyone to rediscover the world. It is an inspiring journey that opens up fresh perspectives. I am afraid we have the wrong keynote presentation. Ali, could we please share the other presentation with Gatsos's journey?
It's the one called Gatsos Slides, I think I renamed it.
Yes, perfect, yes. Perfect, thank you. So remembering Gatsos's journey, to taxivi, we can say that it provides us with a new alphabet through which we can reread the world. To taxivi lipon, and you can see the translation, δείχτε μου δρόμο να περάσω με ήλιο, με βροχή. Θέλω τον κόσμο να διαβάσω και πάλι από την αρχή. Last year, I was fortunate enough to explore Gatsos's poetry together with Susanna and Pavlos, our two brilliant students, who were particularly intrigued by the famously elusive poem Amorgos. I am thankful to Professor Roilos for offering such an insightful analysis of the poem earlier. As Odysseas Elitis has astutely observed, in order to appreciate this fascinating poem, one needs to be endowed with what Elitis calls poetic intelligence. And maybe we can move to the next slide, which is also the last one. Here we can see Elitis and Gatsos. Pavlos and Susanna are both highly sensitive readers of poetry. I'm very proud of them. I'm so happy that they graciously agreed to share with us their thoughts on Amorgos and some of its translations. Pavlos, Susanna, from Greece, where you are, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Calliope. We're both really delighted to participate today in the celebration of Gatsos' poetry and translation. We've been learning Greek for several years now, and Gatsos has been one of our literary companions the entire time. In fact, during our first semester of modern Greek classes with Calliope in fall 2018, Calliope brought us to a performance of his songs at Harvard. And then in the summer of 2019, we were inspired by his poem, Amor Ghost, to visit the island in honor of that poem, despite the fact that he famously never visited the island himself. This poem has inspired many people in various ways since it was written, and especially since it was translated. And this is the main thing we'd like to share with you today. And Ali, we can switch to the other presentation now and go to slide number two.
Thank you. So yeah, this is an interesting document from the Gatsos archive. And it's a letter written to Gatsos by a publisher in New York who has encountered Amor Ghos in a literary journal. And I might just read it out quickly. Our mutual friend, Eugene Istomin, has introduced me to your poem Amor Ghos, translated by Konstantinos Lavas in the autumn 64 issue of Generation. Do you have a collection of poems that we at Doubleday should read and consider for publication? I find Amor Ghos a very exciting poem. Since I don't read Greek, I don't know whether it is a good or remarkable translation, but it certainly has enormous color and vitality. And I think one of the things that really stands out here is the way the kind of vibrancy and what he calls the vitality of this poem stands out in translation. We'll have a little more to say about this particular translation soon, but I can we move to the next slide? we were also really taken by these comments that a more recent translator of the poem made about it. So I'll read this aloud again. I was driven to translate the entire poem because at a very vulnerable time in my life, someone in a dark coffee house passed me a fragment from the end of part one. As soon as I learned enough Greek to read this fragment in the original, I sought out the rest. At the time, I was unable to find an English translation of the entire poem. So I sat with my dictionary and began to generate a picture puzzle by translating word after word. This is a foolish and desperate way to go about such a task, but sometimes it's the only way possible. And I think one of the sort of really striking things about this is the way, the effect that even just a fragment of this poem had upon this translator. She was inspired to learn Greek just to read this poem. And her sort of efforts to her efforts to understand it were kind of a struggle, but and as she calls it, a foolish and desperate way to go about such a task. But there's this kind of urgency and this drive to engage more closely with the poem. And this is something that resonates actually with the poetics of the poem ourselves, as Suzanne will comment on. Can we go to the next slide?
So we wanted to highlight these few lines from part two of the poem, which speaks to this idea that Paul just spoke about from Anita Sullivan of the compulsive vitality of the poem. I'll read these lines in English, and then you can see the Greek as well. But here on the riverbank, only one way exists. Only one way, a trick, but you have to take it. You have to thrust yourself into the blood before time catches up with you and pass over to the other side to find your inmates again, blossoms, birds, deers. Though there's only one way, which might otherwise seem deterministic, Gatsos infuses the act of taking that way with energy and agency as you thrust yourself onto the past, no turning back. The life force conveyed here resonates throughout the poem. The last thing that we'd like to share with you are the final lines in which Gatsos reflects on the energy and work that goes into creating poetry, just to have that feeling of vitality, even if it's fleeting. Now we can go to the next slide.
I guess this is the Greek text, and I just want us to pay particular attention to these underlined parts, and kind of particularly to this these three words here, nasir pare goriso, in order to console you, something like this. Can we go to the next slide now? And this is actually the translation by Konstantinos Lavos that our editor from the first slide encountered. And if you had a look at the Greek text and you know Greek, you'll notice that this is quite a free translation. There's a lot changed here. You'll notice we have this little line, nasir pareoriso, that has kind of disappeared. It's kind of been subsumed into the second line. There's a lot that's kind of changed in this version of the poem. But clearly something came through. There's still, as the editor recognized, this vitality of the poem. It still communicates this vital force that I think is so compelling about this poem. So here, can we go to the next slide? And now we have the translation of Anita Sullivan, whose comments we read just before. And this is a much more literal translation, a much more careful translation, I think, that came across in her comments before. And I think one of the things that doing this, looking at the translation, is to think about the Greek text. I think reading these translations can inspire us to like Anita Sullivan, to want to get better at Greek, to encounter the poem as it's meant to be.
And in the work that we do as students of Greek and as scholars, there's of course some conception of knowledge of the poem that we're studying, of progress in our Greek language skills, and even maybe potentially of mastery. But in studying the poem and its translation, this also gives us the chance to spend more time with the poem and in the realm of poetry in general, which is often what inspires us in the first place, and can be a continual source of energy throughout life if we only take the time. And it is this appreciation of the life force of Gatsos's poetry that's the main message that we want to leave you with today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Suzanne, Paul. It's time for one more short poetic interlude. This is the song As Primera Que Llamas, Bright Day. I would like to bring back Angela Gentile, the poet of Argentina, to read the Italian translation.
Un giorno chiaro anche per noi, con una mia lacrima salmastra, naffierò il tempo. Stati amare, ho imparato a vivere accanto a te. Di colombe morte, ha rimpianto il cielo l'alba. Ritornerò, Madonna dolorata, addio, non piangere, impara a non indossare il tormento come talismano. Di, non importa, verrà un giorno chiaro anche per noi.
Thank you. Now it is time for me to turn the floor over again once more to Professor Roilos for an introduction of our guest of honor, Mrs. Nana Mouskouri. Professor Roilos.
Hi, yes, I'm here.
Here you are. Go ahead.
Okay. Of course, Mrs. Mouskouri's presence makes the commemoration of Gatsos's 110th birthday this afternoon especially significant. Mrs. Mouskouri needs, of course, no introduction. She has been a legendary figure of global song culture since the early 1960s. She has recorded songs in no less than 21 languages. Mrs. Mouskouri was born in Chania, Crete, and studied classical music at the Athens Conservatoire. She became broadly known in Greece in 1959, when she received the first and second prizes at the Greek Song Festival, with the songs Kapu Ipavhi Agapi Mu, My Love Exists Somewhere, music by Manos Hatzidakis and lyrics by Nikos Gatsos. And Ξέρω Κάποιο Αστέρι, I Know of Some Star, music Mimis Plessas, and lyrics by Kostas Petentevis. In 1960, Mrs. Mouskouri won the first prize at the Mediterranean Song Festival in Barcelona with the song Ξύπνα Αγάπη Μου, Wake Up My Love, music and lyrics by Kostas Giannidis. The following year, in 1961, the German version of Hatzidakis's When You Whistle Three Times, Όταν Σφυρίξεις, Σαν Σφυρίξεις Τρεις Φορές, Weiße Rosen aus Athen, this is the title of the German version, became the first of the dozens of her international hits. It sold more than 1 million copies only in Germany. Mrs. Mouskouri's international career ever since has acquired the status of a legend in global song culture. Indicative of her unique impact is, among many other things, the fact that she has sold over 300 million records all over the world. In addition to her status as an international musical icon, Mrs. Mouskouri is also a devoted activist. Since 1993, she has served as a UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador. The motto of her webpage on the UNICEF website is indicative of her humanistic values. Quote, "Everywhere I went, I realized that children are society's victims. We have a duty to speak to political leaders, to influence people, to give these children a better future," end of quote. I have always found inspiring Mrs. Mouskouri's and Nikos Gatsos's long, genuine, and exemplary friendship, which was based on mutual loyalty and respect. The Gatsos Archive at Harvard's Houghton Library in Cambridge, Massachusetts, includes some significant tokens of this friendship. I'm referring to the no less than 75 postcards that Mrs. Mouskouri sent to Nikos Gatsos from all over the world in the late 1960s, in the 1970s, and 1980s. And I guess now, Keith, we can, yes, see some examples of those cards from Switzerland, France, England, the US, Canada, Mexico, Ecuador, Argentina, Germany, Austria, the Netherlands, Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Ireland, China, Taiwan, Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, South Africa, New Zealand, Australia, Ivory Coast, and several other countries. Now, Mrs. Mouskouri. Mrs. Mouskouri, hi. Could you
please... Hello,
Would you allow me to ask you a few questions about your collaboration and friendship with Nikos Gatsos?
Of course, this is why I'm here.
Exactly.
Because Nikos, you know, my emotion is great and I'm very grateful to everybody that really invites me today. And I go through the whole thing, you know, that's some very moves and yes.
Great.
So ask me and I tell you something which I wish to tell you as well.
Good. So could you please tell us a few things about your friendship with Nikos Gatsos? How and when did it begin?
Nikos Gatsos was with Manos Hatzidakis together, of course, at the beginning. The two people that they offered me songs with which the people recognized me. Because, of course, I worked with other musicians at the beginning, but they were not records or so. But I belong to them. I am, when I was invited, they gave me songs, and with these songs, I became very popular not only in Greece, but also in other countries. But what was important is the first song that I recorded with Manos Hatzidakis and Nikos, it was a 45 45, how do you call it at the time? And Hartinoto Fegaraki was there. Hartinoto Fegaraki became my guide somehow. It's to believe and to follow the truth. Gatsos was very sensitive. All his life, I think, through his writings, was speaking about the freedom and also the truth, but the real truth. Mm-hmm. That was it. And this is why he gave me an advice that in life is very important to learn. And also, it's the road is long, but the important is that you don't get to the frontiers very easily. So he made a spot for me and he said, you have to have as a border, as a frontier, the sun. And he wrote a song for that as well. So what I mean is that he was so profound. I cannot speak to you about the technical side of the things, but he was a perfectionist, I may say. But the most important is that the feeling and the truth that there was in his music made me also, when I started to sing outside Greece, when I was invited in the 60s to come out because of Never on Sunday, it was not his song, but it was among the songs of that they were at the festival. And so this was very important for me. Gatsos was a very difficult friend. But he was also very generous and he was very emotional, his feelings. And when I say that at the beginning in the song that has written for me the songs, he did not agree with me from the beginning that I was right. And then one day he came and he told me, I think you don't know what you sing. And I was really embarrassed. And I said, but why? I said, you don't understand. And then he said to me, I don't know. Then he started to listen to me, the songs I was doing at the time as a young girl. I was singing in a nightclub with jazz and Elvis Presley and rock and roll. And then he was listening to his songs when I was singing. And maybe this was the reason why he thought that. Anyway, a little bit more later, a bit later, he came to me one night at the nightclub and he said, I won't talk to you about all the things, all the songs that you sing, but I will talk to you for Hartinoto Fegaraki. This is your song. And I think you will never leave it on the side. You will sing. And what came from the fact that he was saying that I don't understand, maybe it was the fact that also helped me to go deeper in the songs. And when I came over to Europe or to England or to America or wherever, the people liked me to sing in Greek. Mm-hmm. Because maybe they were not only the Greek people, but also the others. Maybe because I could express the feelings of the song on my language better than if I was doing a translation. I mean, there were a lot of things that have been translated. I was sorry I couldn't participate when they were talking about translation because I know a little bit about it. But Nikos is, I think he's always with me and he advises me whatever I do. And this is it. I think he gave me also a line which I followed in my life. to follow the truth, to be honest, because she couldn't afford really the people who will do mistakes and don't, they are not on the truth. But at the end, she was really happy because they changed the road. He wanted the truth. He wanted me to be as real as possible. And I may say that that with the Manos Kazerakis and Nikos Gatsos songs, I came over everywhere. The White Rose of Athens became my passport somehow passed. But many other songs, yes. But As Primera, and especially now that there are so many problems in the world, the people, they tell me, don't worry, Nana, As Primera. Mm-hmm. You know, and did this by telling a few words at the beginning, and then the people, they like to listen to the language. Of course, for other poets, I don't say that, but I started with him. Mm-hmm. That's the most important, my beginning, and this I owe him. And his words, because he will change the word. The words were so important for him. How do you say? And what? And this is what was good also for the translations, because they would not betray him. You know, they were giving him the truth he needed to be expressed. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, thank you. If you could allow me. To refer to another extremely important contribution of yours to the dissemination of Greek musical culture. Let me remind our audience that you had an extremely successful program at BBC in the late 1960s and 1970s.
Well, it was started.
You promoted Greek song.
It was a problem with Yvonne Littlewood. She was my producer. And we started in 68 and we finished in the 80s sometime, yes. And in this program, that's what you say is really, really true, because first of all, I had to say something about my Greek songs that I was singing. But also, every show, we started with a Greek song.
Exactly.
Yeah. And sometimes it was a folkloric song or a traditional song, but it was always a Greek. It was a spot, yes. Yeah.
Yes. Now, I would like to ask you something else, a more general question. If you wish, could you tell us how you experienced the Greek 1960s? Which, as we all know, was an important era for Greek cultural life, but especially turbulent one for Greek politics. How did you experience that period?
Well, it was really very hard for me because I never wanted to participate, you know, in politics. That is for me, I think, which I think even now that the people have the right to believe what they believe, but they don't have the right to reject, because there is somewhere, there is a truth always to find out. So I didn't, and my friend Melina Mouskouri and Nikos Gatsos, really, they didn't want me to they told me, because it's better not to participate if you are going to do a fault, which you cannot repair also, which is very difficult. So it was a hard time. It was going to sing in other countries, for instance, and one party would just say something, that they will whistle, or they would, because I didn't say something that they expected me to do. But my country, I was very proud. They had their problems, they have to solve them. For me, I'm proud, and I had to give the best that I know from my country also, mm-hmm. and which is having friends like Nikos Gatsos, who speaks about the truth humanly and does not want to hurt anybody. And he loved freedom, and freedom is something that he has sung, written many, many, many times, you know, even in Amoros, you know. And so it was very important for me. So I went like I went, keeping always my country high up, and I respect my country, and this is why I respect every country in the world, every language, every. It is very important because we don't know everything. And like Gatsos said, I have to keep my frontiers, is the sun. Mm-hmm. If I get towards the sun, close to the sun, it will be the end, of course, but it will be the beginning of something else, greater also. You know, it's He was my guide, without telling me you do this or that, but he will take it out with the questions, with the songs that he's written. And you see, with his songs, I received many answers of the young girl that I was, and I had questions. And I still do that through the songs that I sing. Of course, I sing some simple also, because they're simple songs, but the most of the time they are for him. And what is wonderful is that the people, like my producer who was doing really my records and everything, working with me, and he tried always to find the equivalent of the song in Greek, that it will be translated in a very, very special way. And also is not to betray, you know, the original. It's very important.
It's very important, which leads me to my following question.
Yes.
Which is, does your interpretive performative approach to the same song differ according to the languages in which you perform that song? And for instance, I know that Keith is going to play to share with us some part of the Korean version of the Siren Song. The Korean version of that song. So, did you approach the Korean version in a different way than you approached the original Greek?
You know, when I went to Korea, and of course I knew, because there were two, the young composers who sing the song, they were composers and they did the song, and then they put the translation, and then of course they sang it. So when I heard, I sang this song before to them, and I explained what it was saying, when it translates, they made it similar thing. It was a farewell song. Yeah, okay. It was a farewell song. And every time I go to a country, I at the beginning, of course, because when I go over and over, I repeat it. So I always like to take a traditional song, something that at the end, and sing it with the language as well. In each language, you know, even if I don't speak. Of course, afterwards I get dictionaries and things which I had with me to be able to translate what it was saying and learn a few words also. Because it's good to, when you go somewhere and they welcome you, to be able also to give back something, some emotion. So afterwards I sang the song, and I found that the way they've written, they explained me exactly what this was sitting. And I thought that the translation was also a little bit recreation, but in the same way, But they said that in their own language. They said that with the best thing they could do to explain this. This is very important to try to have a very good translator who will really help to that. Yes. And I sang it, and it was a very big hit.
Yeah, I'm sure. Since you sang it.
It was a hit with the two boys who sang it, but I was very happy that they accepted it also from me. This is the satisfaction. Yes.
Great. So, of course, among the very many songs composed by Manos Hatzidakis in lyrics by Nikos Gatsos, you have performed, some songs initially intended and performed in theater or in films, like Hartinot of a Gavaki.
Yes.
Yeah, that was performed for a performance of The Streetcar Named Desire.
Yes,
Streetcar. Exactly.
Which one? The other one?
To Asteri to Voria,
yes.
America.
America, yes. Exactly.
So my question, I don't know if you have a specific answer, but I would be very interested in finding out if your interpretation of this, let's say, markedly performative songs intended for theater or films, was a bit different from your interpretive approach to other songs.
They are a little bit different because you have to understand the story, why it was done, how this is very, very important to know why you do it and what was the situation that you did it. And Hartinot of a Gavaki, finally, which was written for the Streetcar Named Desire. Yeah. And so I learned it, and it was Melina Mouskouri who really interpreted the song. For me, I had to forget why, because it was more. And I think Nikos changed a few things just to make it more personal or human, more human. That happens now, and it does not remind the story of it became for me, as I told you before, the song of my life, because also it speaks about the truth. Mm-hmm. Yes. And if you believe, you know, everything can be real. You know, and this is also with for a friendship, for a love, love has a different directions, you know, because it's not only one love. It has many faces, whether it is for a child, for a mother, for a lover, love that Nikos writes about, it's the love of the person that will sing it and believe in it. And this, I think, it's a heritage that I took from, not only from my family for certain things, but from Nikos and his writings, because he wanted the real reality. And he was surrealist. Huh? So he was one of the first ones surrealist. Yet. This is that he was going above the reality for the things. And this is what I loved, because I think to interpret, because I became like this as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you're absolutely right. Even, you know, his lyrics are invested with a very, very marked and sometimes, of course, multi-layered, transcendental approach to reality or to surreality.
Yes.
One of my, if you allow me, one of my most favorite, I love all the songs that you have performed. Yeah. But one of my most favorite interpretations of yours is your singing of the song cycle, to use Hadzidakis' term, Mythi Mias Ginekas, Myths of a Woman. Which was characteristically different from other works by Hadzidakis and Gatsos you had performed before.
Yes, but the text that Nikos has written, they are extraordinary. But it was the only time that Manos, while he was directing me in the studio, because in fact, I must say that I was a student at the beginning at the conservatory, but Manos added to a certain power to the songs when it should be very, very, very soft, when it should be very, very, that you can reach the end of your forces to see. And in this particular record, and Nikos was exactly what he made me even screaming and things, which it's not my personal, but the songs are marvelous. Yeah. I mean, it was very difficult. And I said to myself that it's pity because Manos is not here, of course, anymore, but even with him and some younger musicians to sing it again, or I sing it one day, because this and also the Amor Gosh, I didn't sing because it was done far after, you see, so it was enough. So I did not participate, and I was sorry. But I don't know how much time I have, but it's always time. I have to be, But it is true, the myth of a woman is really a strange way that I sing, but he wanted me to sing like this. Mm-hmm. For example, now if I sing on stage, it is different than when he would tell me to sing, But Manos was a great musician, also. I learned a lot from him.
And your performance of that cycle of songs. Yes. It's fabulous. It's amazing.
You think so?
No. That's very, very much like it.
I'm not very happy.
you're extremely modest, which is another sort of lesson that we're learning from you right now and throughout your amazing career. You're an extremely modest person. And I greatly appreciate that. Now, going back to the myths of a woman, a more personal question. Do you have a favorite song from that cycle of songs?
I don't know. There are very, very great women. He describes a wonderful woman and that, which is, but if I think, like I say, to me, to Tamohora, it's Uncle Sue. Yes, for me. And she was a singer that I really loved very, very much. I admire her, and too. So it is, and this is also spooky somehow, to sing it. I have because it speaks about things that don't exist, but the lyrics are so great, yeah. And I think this made Manos also to be that aggressive in this, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because the lyrics are visually aggressive. It's not said, but in this way, but somehow the images are cruel sometimes.
Yeah, the reality.
Yeah. If not, all right. Yes.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much, Mrs. Mouskouri. I have so many questions for you, but I don't know if we have the time to continue. Keith, what do you think?
I hate to cut this conversation short. I want to tell you, you should go as long as you have the strength the rest of the day.
Maybe we
could play one song and bring it to a close, perhaps.
What do you as primera, or what do you have to play? Agathi told me that you have something.
Yes, we have that one. We have Paper Moon and the North Star.
And I said, which is a very nice, absolutely wonderful song.
Could you also hear the Korean version?
I have a Korean. I can manage to send it to you if you, but I don't have it here, but I can manage to be sent to you if you want. Yes.
Keith has it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we can play it here. We'll start with that one.
Hear this right now, Mrs. Mouskouri.
Okay, this will take a moment.
Yeah, you have it in Korea? Yes. 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 Agathi maybe gave it to your mom, because I don't know if she had it. You know, I did a record afterwards with some songs from the countries I have visited, but I mean, the world is very big, I didn't do. But I have songs in, like I have in, how do you say, the Korean, there is a Chinese, other song, of course, Taiwan, of course, it's a Dutch, German, of course. German, I have a lot of songs, yes. You know, like I say, the manners in the times where the songs have become successful, he did a record, Elasi Chora Ton Onirom is the title, and it is all that were, it's for Greece, and images for Greece, and then there was only music, and I sing in this one, five songs. Of
Nicolas, I think.
And then it was, Manos has written also, Thalassa Platia. There are five songs that Nikos has written. And these songs are the songs really that in Germany were very, very popular. Mm-hmm. From this, it was tied with the Greek land. You know, for the Greece,
I found the Korean version. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Is this a good time for the Korean version?
I guess.
Oh. Okay.
Okay.
Oh,
You know, the funny thing is that I think Nick was going with the music, you know, that helped him to open also his feelings to find things more easily. I think the music helped him a lot with that, because he was searching for love, but the true love, you know. And I think with his songs, people feel it when you read the lyrics of him. And I would tell to Agathi to give you I don't know if she has given you a thing that he has written for me when he first saw me. No? Oh, she didn't? No. I don't want to take your time.
No, please, go ahead, please. Yes.
He said, well, I have it in Greek, so I translate. Yeah, well, he said, this girl, he said that the first time he has saw me, it was in a club singing, and he said, this girl is like a boat that travels, a sort of strange image came into my mind, you know, when I first heard Nana for the first time, before many, many years ago. She was singing in a nightclub close to the sea, in Athens, of course. And I heard her singing American songs with the orchestra and different other languages. I didn't know then who she was or what is her name, but her voice and the very warm, sympathetic face of her with an image of the boat that traveled, you know, that was sailing. They stayed in my mind for many, many years. They stayed in his mind. Mm-hmm. In his mind, yeah. I couldn't imagine that one year later I would have to write a song, lyrics for her first song in Greek. And after the lyrics of almost all her songs that she had ever sang in Greek. Oh, no. I couldn't even imagine that one day I would have this tight friendship that for years now is really alive and adiatarach and undisturbed. Undisturbed. Yeah. He said, Γεια σου, Νάνα, καράβι που ταξιδεύεις, boats that you are traveling in all the time new oceans. I hope that the winds that to be always very favorite and for you and to visit and discover Seferis from lands, no? Seferis, yes, yeah. Seferis. And seas, of course, and water, and try. I hope that you meet lands and seas. Will be tamed by the magic of your voice and the peace of the truth that you carry with you. Mm-hmm. That was Nikos.
Mrs. Mouskouri.
Always,
that was very moving, and I was wondering, because this is an important document, whether you could read this letter in the original, in Greek.
Yes, I will send it to you.
No, if you could read it now in Greek, could you?
Yes, in Greek, of course.
Thank you.
Okay, I don't know why I translated. Okay. Αυτό το κορίτσι είναι ένα καράβι που ταξιδεύει. Μια τέτοια παράξενη εικόνα μου ήρθε στο νου όταν είδα και άκουσα την Άννα για πρώτη φορά πριν από χρόνια, σε ένα παραθαλάσσιο κεντρικό νυχτερινό κέντρο της Αθήνας, να τραγουδάει αμερικάνικα τραγούδια με την ορχήστρα. Δεν ήξερα τότε ποια ήταν, ούτε και πώς τη λέγανε, αλλά η φωνή της και το ζεστό συμπαθητικό της πρόσωπο, μαζί με την εικόνα του καραβιού που ταξίδευε, έμειναν για πολύ καιρό χαραγμένα στη μνήμη μου. Πού να φανταστώ ότι ένα χρόνο αργότερα θα της έγραφα τα λόγια για το πρώτο τραγούδι της στα ελληνικά και κατόπιν τα λόγια όλων σχεδόν των τραγουδιών που τραγούδησε στη μητρική της γλώσσα. Πού να φανταστώ ακόμα ότι θα με έδαινε μαζί της μια μεγάλη φιλία που χρόνια τώρα εξακολουθεί να μένει ζωντανή και αδιατάραχτη. Γεια σου, Νάνα, καράβι που ταξιδεύεις σε καινούριους όλο ένα ωκεανούς. Εύχομαι η άνεμη να σου είναι πάντα ευνοϊκή και οι ανεξερεύνητες στεριές και θάλασσες που θα δεις να ημερέψουν, που θα δεις να ημερέψουν από τη μαγεία της φωνής σου και από τη γαλήνη της αλήθειας που κουβαλάς μέσα σου.
Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ.
Το έκανα λάθος πάλι στο τέλος, δεν πειράζει. Θέλετε να πω άλλη μια φορά το τελευταίο?
Ναι, αν μπορείτε.
Ναι. Γεια σου, Νάνα, καράβι που ταξιδεύει σε καινούριους όλο ένα ωκεανούς. Εύχομαι η άνεμη να σου είναι πάντα ευνοϊκή και οι ανεξερεύνητες στεριές και θάλασσες που θα δεις να ημερέψουν από τη μαγεία της φωνής σου και από τη γαλήνη της αλήθειας που κουβαλάς μέσα σου. Αυτό είναι το πιο... Η γαλήνη της αλήθειας που κουβαλάς μέσα σου είναι πάρα πολύ... Γι' αυτό σας λέω ότι ο Νίκος κυνηγούσε... δεν ξέρω να ξέρετε, μια φορά και έναν καιρό...
Λένε τα παραμύθια.
Κυνηγούσα το όνειρο για να μάθω την αλήθεια. Να είναι ήλιος, να αναστέλει. Ποιος την είδε, ποιος την ξέρει. Αχ, γιατί, αχ, γιατί να έχει τη ζωή ξεχαστεί. Αυτό είναι από τα ωραιότερα τραγούδια που έχει γράψει. Κυνηγούσα το όνειρο, γι' αυτό σας λέω, σε όλη τη ζωή κυνηγούσε το όνειρο να μάθει την αλήθεια. Την αγάπη, μια αγαπημένη κοπέλα, καταλάβατε. Ήταν πάντοτε στο ψάξιμο αυτό. Να ψάχνει, να το βρει ποια είναι η αληθινή αγάπη.
Mrs. Mouskouri, of course we all know that Gatsos began his poetic career as a surrealist. So let me conclude with a rather surrealist question. If Nikos Gatsos were with us today, yes, if he were still alive, okay. If you were with us this afternoon, this evening, what kind of song you would have asked me to write for you?
I never asked him the songs what to write about me. He was the searcher, and he was really the one who will bring it to you because he could not sing it, but he was happy that the people would listen to it. Of course, he would always, he had a few favorite singers, not only me, but some others, that they followed maybe a little bit my way of listening to him. They went deeper than to say the song and the words. But he needed to write. He needed to write and to learn. I think we learn. He told me that I will learn all my life, and he's right, because every day, every minute, we learn something. And you don't learn it very easily, so you have to try to live and learn the most you can. That is why, until we reach the sun. Huh? Mm-hmm. The sun sets, let's say. But it is, you know, vale ton ilio sinoro. Είναι από τα πιο εκεί που πας αγόρι πικραμένο βάλε τον ήλιο σύνορο και όταν θα έρθεις ρίξε ξανά και έλεγε στον άσο πίσω από την πόρτα τη κλειστή.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Mouskouri, for sharing all this extremely interesting and important experience with us this evening. It has been an extremely moving experience for me, and I'm sure for all the other members of the audience.
Yes.
Let me thank you as one of the many, many millions of your admirers, but also in my capacity as the professor of Greek studies, modern Greek studies at Harvard, for disseminating Greek musical culture and the Greek language all over the world. You have been a great ambassador of Greek culture. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, and to you too, and all of you that you have. And thank you to Agathi, who gave me the chance. He gave me the chance with you to be with you today. Thank you very much. I hope everything will be all right. I hope. Huh? Keep our fingers crossed.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you so much for this wonderful conversation and reminiscences. We have one more poetic postlude. It is now. Yeah. Agathi Dimitrouka will read.
Agathi? Hello?
And we need to have the...
Thank you very much.
Of the poem.
Yeah.
Here we go. Okay, Agathi.
I'm sorry. Read it now, after this emotion.
Yes.
You want to go to the other one?
Χελιδόνησε κλουβί. Πού το πάνε το παιδί, χελιδόνησε κλουβί. Πού το πάνε το παιδί και κανείς δεν το έχει δει. Πού το πάνε το παλικάρι, κάθε νύχτα με φεγγάρι. Πού το πάνε, τι του λένε και τα αδέρφια του το κλαίνε. Στις ψυχής μου τον καθρέφτη, ίσκιος άρχισε να πέφτει. Ίδια η μοίρα που με φέρνει, ίδια η μοίρα που με παίρνει. Με κοιτάνε κάθε αυγή και τα μάτια τους πληγεί. Με κοιτάνε κάθε αυγή και τα λόγια τους κραυγεί. Με κοιτάνε και τα μαύρα τους φοράνε. Κι ένας παραπέρα στέκει και κρατάει αστροπελέκι. Στις ψυχής μου τον καθρέφτη, ίσκιος άρχισε να πέφτει. Ίδια η μοίρα που με φέρνει, ίδια η μοίρα που με παίρνει.
Πού το πάνε το παιδί. Αγαθή, πού το πάνε το παιδί.
Χελιδόνησε κλούδι.
Αξίδι,
εμένα ήμουνα 11 χρονών όταν βγήκε το τραγούδι αυτό και η στίχη που μου αυτό που είχε καρφωθεί και η στίχη που μου καρφώθηκαν στο μυαλό και με απασχολούσαν, με παίζω και σκεφτόμουν, ήταν αυτό το στις ψυχής μου τον καθρέφτη, ίσκιος άρχισε να πέφτει. Αυτό ήταν, και έτσι ένιωσα, ταυτιζόμουν αυτούς τους στίχους.
Σε καταλαβαίνω πάρα πολύ, γιατί και εγώ ήμουν μεγαλύτερη από σένα και την εποχή, αλλά είχα αυτή την έννοια μαζί. Κατάλαβε, ήταν ενωμένα μαζί μου. Ήθελα να ψάξω κι εγώ, ήθελα να το βρω κι εγώ. Αυτό που λέω για όλο τον κόσμο. I think that this is also something that I was influenced completely. I said that for Keith. No, you listen to me or not? Yeah, because for all the people that they listen to the songs of Nikos, not only me when I sing, but the others as well. But this is the most wonderful thing. They prefer to sing it in English, in Greek. They like the sound of the language and the emotion that comes from the language. So I said, after that, everybody thinks like that. Yeah, why they speak as primera que llamas when there is a problem? No, just get the courage. Τι κοπόσα, το καταλαβαίνεις Αγαθή. Για να πάρουν κουράγιο, μου γράφουν, να τα προβλήματα αρχίζουν, as primera que llamas. The fans do, and I appreciate very much. And other things as well, but Harden to Fekarai, of course, the house sings with me all the time. They know the songs. Nico. Yeah. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. C'est vrai, huh? I hope that. So let's hope next year.
Good. Yes, yeah. For the 111th anniversary.
Don't forget me, huh? Don't forget to invite me.
Okay, it's a deal. Agathi, do you think we should end with that last poem?
What?
Totaxidi? Agathi, do you think that we should end with Totaxidi?
Oh, yes, yeah. That's great.
Okay, so this will be our last act. We'll now hear a reading of this poem.
Είναι η τελευταία στίχη που έγραψε ο Νίκος Γκάτσος σε μουσική του Μάνου Χατζηδάκη, που ήταν από το America America η μουσική αυτή.
Μελωδία. Πώς μπορείς να μου το
στείλεις μια φορά,
να μου
και το είναι, ναι, και είναι, έτυχε να έχει, να είναι αυτή η τελευταία στίχη που έγραψε. Λοιπόν, το ταξίδι. Τρέχω, πετάω, κυνηγάω, πουλιά και όνειρα και κάθε μέρα κολυμπάω σε πιο βαθιά νερά. Θέλω τον κόσμο να αγκαλιάσω με ένα ζεστό φιλί και από τη δύση μου να φτάσω στην Ανατολή. Μα είναι φίδι το ταξίδι, είναι χολή μαζί και ξίδι σε ένα μεγάλο αγκάθινο σταυρό. Όμως εγώ δεν κάνω πίσω, ούτε το δρόμο μου να φαφίσω, ως που λιμάνι σίγουρο να βρω. Θέλω τον κόσμο να αγκαλιάσω με ένα γλυκό φιλί και από τη δύση μου να φτάσω ως την Ανατολή. Τρέχω, πετάω, χαιρετάω τα πιο τρελά παιδιά και κάθε πέτρα που πατάω ανοίγει σαν καρδιά. Δείχτε μου δρόμο να περάσω με ήλιο, με βροχή. Θέλω τον κόσμο να διαβάσω και πάλι απ' την αρχή. Μα είναι φίδι το ταξίδι, είναι χολή μαζί και ξίδι σε ένα μεγάλο αγκάθινο σταυρό. Όμως εγώ δεν κάνω πίσω, ούτε το δρόμο μου θα αφήσω, ως που λιμάνι σίγουρο να βρω. Δείχτε μου δρόμο να περάσω με ήλιο, με βροχή. Θέλω τον κόσμο να διαβάσω και πάλι απ' την αρχή.
Ω, Μπαϊκούτς, καταπληκτικό. Θα μου το στείλεις, Αγαθή.
Βεβαίως.
Να πω, εντάξει, όταν θα έρθω, λες, αλλά στείλ μου να τα έχω μέσα, γιατί θα μου δώσουν μια όθηση να ηχογραφήσω, ίσως. Okay.
This is a promise.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was really wonderful for me. Oh,
this was so beautiful. Thank you.
That's really nice.
Agathi, thank you, everyone. And all of you out there, thank you for joining us. Yeah, see you next year.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ευχαριστώ και καληνύχτα.
Καληνύχτα σας.
Καληνύχτα σας.